إلهنا ما أعد لك مليك كل من ملك لبيك قد لبيت لك لبيك إن الحمد لك إلهنا ما أعد لك مليك كل
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على أشرف المخلوقين سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. إن شاء الله today we'll be talking about the history of الكعبة المشرفة. This beautiful place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for some hikmah, some wisdom that we may not know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose this place to be the place called the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be the place that he said, "Inna awwala baytin wudi'a lin-nas," the very first place that was established for the human being, to be called the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why Mecca? Why that specific place in that area? In an area where there is nothing, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in the Quran, ala lisani Ibrahim, when Ibrahim said, Rabbi inni askantu dhurriyati biwadin ghayri di zar'in inda baytik al-muharram. He said, oh my Lord, I left my family in a place, in a valley, when there's nothing. No water, no grass, no trees. And a simple question, I don't know if any one of you had the chance to think about it. Why Hajj and Umrah and this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is located in an area which is super hot? The temperature is very high. There is no grass. There is no beautiful trees. There is no snow. There's no rivers. There is no such a thing. If a person wants to go for a visit to a place, he may choose somewhere in Europe, in Asia, in Africa, in America. But in the middle of the desert, where there's nothing except heat and extreme heat, maybe there's a wisdom there that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to come this house, not for any reason, but only for him to take that struggle, to take that hot weather, to take that area where you're not going to enjoy the views around you, but only mountains, and those mountains are dark. Stones, no grass on those mountains should be a reason for that. I said the reason that this Hajj is only for him, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The historians said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has something called Al-Baytul Ma'mur, somewhere in the heaven, someone in the seventh heaven. And in that Baytul Ma'mur, that Al-Baytul Ma'mur, the house which is always crowded in the seventh heaven, يَدْخُلُهُ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ سَبْعُونَ أَلْفًا مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Every single day, 70,000 angels enter that Baytul Ma'mur to make the tawaf, and these are angels, to make the tawaf in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Baytul Ma'mur. And 70,000 angels every day, they will not have a chance to do it again. Now start making your own calculation. From the very first day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this world, every day 70,000 angels enter that place, make the tawaf, they don't come back again. make a small calculation, you're good in math maybe, and you're going to tell me how many billions or trillions or whatever of angels they had the honor to enter that house, that Baytul Ma'mur, from the very first day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ. Nobody knows the number of the soldiers of your Lord, but only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to have a similar house, but on this earth. According to the historians, angels maybe put the structure of this house, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that place called now Al-Kaaba. Maybe it was built by angels, according to some. Maybe it was built first by Adam alayhi salam. Maybe that. But some people may say, we don't know, but we know that Ibrahim is the one who built the Kaaba. Ibrahim is the one who built the Kaaba, and that's mentioned in the Quran. And Allah asked him to build the Kaaba. The historians said that the Kaaba that was built in the time of Adam alayhi salam, and that was renovated in the time of his son Shit alayhi salam, which is also was a prophet, that Kaaba was gone completely in the time of Nuh alayhi salam, because of the big tufan, the big flood, which has covered the entire world. But the structure was already being established there. The proof of that, according to the Mufassirin, they said, look at what the ayah says. The ayah says that Ibrahim alayhi salam is saying, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ ذُرِّيَّتِي بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ. Oh Allah, I left my family to live in a valley when there's no grass, nothing there. عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ, by your house. Subhanallah. When Ibrahim alayhi salam left his wife Hajar alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam, there was no house yet. There was no house at all. So how he said, I left my family by your house, meaning the structure of the Kaaba was already there. Ibrahim alayhi salam will go back to Palestine and come back again after a few years. And that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him through a dream when he saw himself sacrificing his son. إسماعيل عليه السلام قال يا بني إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك. Oh my son, I saw myself that I am sacrificing you, slaughtering you, right? And this is one of the شعائر that we do, inshallah, for the Hujjaz, when you sacrifice an animal in Mina, which is the outskirts of Mecca. You remember this experience of Ibrahim عليه السلام, which is we talked about last week or 2 weeks ago. Going back again, so Ibrahim alayhi salam will come, and Ibrahim alayhi salam will be ordered by Allah to build the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibrahim will build the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the structures which was already there. The corners of the Kaaba, each corner of the Kaaba was already appointed, assigned, already probably established by the angels before that. So Ibrahim will build the Kaaba at the point, at the structure where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to do so. He built it with the help of his son Ismail. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ. When Ibrahim and his son Ismail were rising up the قَوَاعِد, the pillars of the Kaaba. And they were saying, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Our Lord, oh, please accept from us. Indeed, you are Sami', you hear everything, Al-Alim, and you know everything. Remember, my brothers and my sisters, Ibrahim was commanded to build. Still, he is asking, oh Allah, accept from me. So when you are in that beautiful area, that amazing area, that blessed area, that Mubarak area, that special area. Remember the da'wah of Ibrahim and ask Allah also to accept from you your hajj, your tawaf, your sa'i, your sacrifice, and every single good deed that inshallah you will be performing. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. Oh Allah, accept from me. Accept from me this sadaqah. Accept from me this salat. Accept from me this tawaf. Accept from me this dua. Accept from me anything. That's Ibrahim alayhi salam. So Ibrahim built the Kaaba. And when he was building the Kaaba, and the Kaaba was built with a certain measuring, which it was only 4 meters, point something, less than 4 point half meter. So when he was building it, he used to have a stone under his feet to help him to reach the top or higher. So he was using that stone again and again and again. And that stone, it has the footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So when he finished building that, you could see the footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salam. That footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salam, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi salam, after a few thousand years, that was called Maqamu Ibrahim. Remember, Maqamu Ibrahim. And you're going to see it now, inshallah, once you go for your Hajj or your Umrah. Right? But you're going to say, how? The Maqam Ibrahim is far from the Kaaba. How he used to stand there and reach the Kaaba? That's not possible. You're right. No magic there. But for specific reason, traffic reason, they decided to push that station all the way to the back. So it would be easy for the people to make the tawaf. That's what we call Maqam Ibrahim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran. وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى. And they took the Maqam of Ibrahim as Musalla, as we pray behind it. We don't pray to the footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salam, but it was a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pray behind the Maqam of Ibrahim. So all of us, we know that after you make the tawaf and you finish your tawaf, your 7 round, you go and you pray behind Maqam Ibrahim, the 2 rak'ahs, which is the first rak'ah with Al-Fatiha and Surat Al-Kafirun, and then Al-Fatiha and Surat Al-Ikhlas. So Ibrahim built the Kaaba, and Ibrahim alayhi salam called the people. وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ. Allah commanded him, call the people. They will come for you, for the Hajj. You will come, so many people. From that day, which is probably around 4,000 years ago, Ibrahim made the call. He didn't use a microphone. He didn't use any social podium, a WhatsApp, a Facebook, or a TV channel, but he called. And that call reached the heart of the believers. And all of them are going to that beautiful place. Some of them, their heart is, I cannot even describe it. When they come closer to that Kaaba, when just hear the word of the Kaaba, when they see the Kaaba, that's the call of Ibrahim. And Allah brought the people. So the Kaaba was built in the time of Ibrahim, as all of us we know, and we spoke about it last time, just a small review. Then, the Kaaba will remain that way. And then Ismail alayhi salam will take care of it. And then the children of Ismail again and again. And the tribe that used to take care of that, it's a tribe which is the tribe of the family of Ismail. The wife of Ismail, it's called Jurhum. But after a while, they're probably going to have a dispute among themselves. They're not going to be in control of the Kaaba. So another tribe will take over, and that's called, subhanAllah, and that's called Al-Amaliq. Al-Amaliq will take care of it. In the time of Al-Amaliq, and later on after, a person, his name, Amr ibn Luhay. Amr ibn Luhay was like the leader in that time of Mecca. He's the one who will be introducing for the very first time the worshipping of idols. How he did that? He was a businessman. He traveled to Syria. He found the people worshipping stones and idols. And he asked about it. And they say these are the intermediate between us and Allah. He's going to bring with him few idols, which is Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, and Manat. And these are mentioned in the Quran. أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعُزَّى وَمَنَاتَ الثَّالِثَةَ. You'll find that. Al-Lat, if you look at this word, it is the feminine form, according to this Jahiliyin, the feminine form of Allah. Al-Lat, Allah. A word in Arabic language, when it finish with a ta, it's actually give the reference that this is a feminine form. Al-Uzza, and that's the similar of Al-Aziz. Al-Uzza with a broken alif in the end, that's also a sign of feminine. It's just like female gods. Manat is the similar for Al-Mannan. So the idol worshipping was established at that time. And then the Arab used to come to the Kaaba, and each one of them used to have his own idol. They used to say that there used to be around 360 idols on the top of the Kaaba, which is represent the number of tribes of Arab that used to come. And of course, every tribe, when they put their own god, their own idol there, they pay for it. So it's like a business, subhanAllah. Things will continue this way. Something also that you should know, Arab continue doing Hajj. You may say, how? Idol worshippers and they do Hajj? Yes, they believe and they know that Ibrahim, it was the great-grandfather and Ismail. So they still remember the remaining or some of the remaining of the deen of Ibrahim, but they mix it with all this deviation which has happened after. By the way, you're going to realize also the tawaf. The Arab used to do the tawaf also. But the funny part, they used to do tawaf while they were clapping. And that's also mentioned in the Quran. They used to do the tawaf, and the people of Mecca established something new. What is it actually? They said, whoever wants to come for Hajj and do the tawaf cannot do the tawaf with their own clothes. Why? They said, because your own clothes are what? Are already filled with sins. You already sinned with these clothes. So what are we going to do? Oh, you have to buy new clothes from the people of Mecca, which is a business again, just a business. And then they used to say, if you cannot buy those clothes, you're not allowed to enter with your own clothes. And you should make the tawaf, azzakumullah, naked with no clothes. And that used to be also something that the Arab before Islam used to perform. Even in the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he became a prophet. Moving on. The next person that we will know that he has some connection with the Kaaba, it's a king which is mentioned in the Quran. His name is Tubba al-Humyari. He was traveling to Medina and he knew about the Kaaba. And for some reasons, he came and he honored the Kaaba by giving the cloth. So the very first person to give the cloth, the kiswa of the Kaaba, because before there was no kiswa, they were not even covered from the top. It was a king called Tubba al-Humyari from Yemen. Things will continue this way, and we don't know that much details about the Kaaba. But we know it has a lot of things inside. It could be some pictures, some idols, some stones, some business. Until the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Prophet was 35 years old, he was not a prophet yet. He became a prophet at the age of 40. A huge big flood took place around the Kaaba, and a part of the Kaaba collapsed. Probably some of the walls collapsed. So, and the water was there, and the people of Quraysh were confused. What should we do with this? So a lot of people, they have a different opinion. Finally, they said, you know what? We cannot just fix it. We have to tear it down and then rebuild it. And they have an emergency meeting. They discuss a lot. They have confusion. Anyway, in the end, they said, okay, we're going to rebuild it. But they were very cautious to do so. Until one of them, his name is Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, which is the father of Khalid ibn al-Walid, and I'm talking about before Islam. He said, I'm an old man. Tomorrow, I'll take my hammer and I will start tearing down the Kaaba. If something happened to me, oh, stop. But if nothing happened to me, come and help me. So he did that the first day and the second day and the third day. They saw that nothing is happening, so they joined him. Another good sign. When the flood was there, a big, huge snake was there. And some of them, they say, oh, this is like the guard of the Kaaba. But subhanAllah, a bird came from nowhere, grabbed that snake, and just fly somewhere. So they rebuild the Kaaba. The interesting thing about this rebuilding the Kaaba in the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, by the idol worshippers, remember, by the idol worshippers, the Qurayshis, they decided to raise funds to rebuild the house of Allah. But they said, we should not put any bad money in rebuilding the house of God. They did not use the word haram and halal, because there's no concept, yes. But they said, not a bad money. And they say money which is collected from some unjust or unfair, or from some prostitute, or from anything which is that, say, no, we're not going to accept that money. So they raised money, and then they started rebuilding the Kaaba. They were short of funds. So when they rebuilt it smaller. It became higher, from 4 meters to 8 meters, but smaller than the old one. So the corners, the four corners that was being built, and there was the Kaaba was built on, now they're not. They're only two corners. So what they did, they said, they built a small half wall around the Kaaba. And you see it, that half circle, which is you're going to see it when you go. And that's called Al-Hatim or Hijr Ismail. In order to tell the people that that part used to be a part of the Kaaba. It used to be what? A part of the Kaaba. That part, by the way, when you make the tawaf, you make sure you don't do tawaf inside there. If you do that, your tawaf is not valid. You have to do it again, because that part is inside the Kaaba. And if you pray in that area, within the Hatim, right? It's like you pray inside the Kaaba. Anyway, so the Kaaba was built. And then the issue was, who's going to put back the black stone? We talked about it last time. We say the black stone is a stone that probably came from heaven by angels or by Adam alayhi salam. It was completely white. But because of the sins of the human being, this stone became dark. So everyone wants to have the honor to put the black stone. Maybe most of us, we know this story. And finally, they decided, you know what? After the long meeting, they say the first person to come from a certain area, from one bed, from one door, he will be the judge. They all agree. Subhanallah, for whatever reason and hikmah, it was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam who was coming from that door. So when they saw him, all of them, they said, oh, as-sadiq al-amin, bihi radina. Oh, this is the trustworthy person, the honest person. We all agree with his decision. So he came and he heard about their confusion. Finally, he came up with this good idea. He took his cloth, his rida, he put it on the ground, put the stone in the middle, and asked the people, the leader of each tribe, you hold on one side. And all of them, they had the honor to carry the black stone, right? To share this honor until they came close to the place where it was supposed to be placed. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, she was not a prophet yet, he took the black stone and he placed it there. And he avoided that big confusion, that big fight that was about to take place there. Subhanallah. When the Islam came, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, one day, and just to share with you this little story, when he became a prophet, the owner of taking care of the Kaaba, opening and closing the doors of the Kaaba, it was in the hand of a family called, subhanAllah, Banu Shayba. And it was in the hand of a person, his name was Uthman ibn Talha. So this Uthman ibn Talha, he had the honor, the authority, the only one among Quraysh to open and close the Kaaba. And he used to do that like once a year, once every 2 months or 3 months to clean the Kaaba. So once he was opening the door and letting people go inside, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam also wanted to enter, but this Uthman ibn Talha didn't allow him. No way, no way. Rasulullah said, please let me go just like anyone else. He said, no, I'm not going to let you. Because at that time, Rasulullah just became a prophet and he was being rejected by most of the people. Rasulullah said to Uthman ibn Talha, oh, Uthman, let me go in. Probably one day I will have the keys of the Kaaba. And Uthman said to him in such a way, like, if that day comes, I would rather to be under the ground than to be alive. Rasulullah was very upset. Subhanallah, the days will turn and Rasulullah will open Mecca and he will go to the Kaaba and he will call one of his companions in a version, could be Ali or Umar radiallahu anhuma. So he asked for the keys of the Kaaba. He say, it is with Uthman ibn Talha. So he sent him, knocking the door of Uthman ibn Talha and asking for the keys. Uthman got very much frustrated. He was not a Muslim yet. And he realized the keys are gone. His mom told him, you remember what you did with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, long time ago. But he doesn't have a choice. He gave the keys of the Kaaba to Umar. Umar brought them. Rasulullah opened the Kaaba, removed all the idols, the pictures, whatever they used to do there, subhanAllah. When he was doing that, an idea came to the mind of Ali radiallahu anh, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the uncle of the Prophet Al-Abbas radiallahu anh, and both of them wants to have this honor to be the carriers of the keys of the Kaaba. So they requested him, can we have that honor, the family of Banu Hashim? And probably Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to do so. But an ayah, subhanallah, will come right away from the seventh heaven. Subhanallah, Jibreel alayhi salam will be sent down to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell him, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. Allah is ordering you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you give back the amana. Back the amana? Yeah, these keys are the amana. Rasulullah will call Uthman ibn Talha to come. He will come and he will give him the keys back. And Uthman will be surprised. Giving me the keys? Are you making fun of me? No, Uthman. The keys are yours. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding me that the keys is yours. Uthman couldn't find anything to say but to say this is the deen ul-haq, the true deen that he accepted Islam. Rasulullah said at that moment, the keys of the Kaaba will remain in the family of Uthman ibn Talha. Guess what? Up to now, to our day today, the carriers of the keys of the Kaaba are the descendants of the Sahabi Uthman ibn Talha. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, will remain with him, with them. لا يأخذه منهم إلا ظالم. Only an unjust, unfair person will take it away from them. Even now, if the king or anyone else wants to enter the Kaaba, he has to come and call the carriers of the keys of the Kaaba, the children of Uthman ibn Talha. The person's name is Abdul Aziz al-Shaybi right now, who is having the keys of the Kaaba, subhanAllah. Continuing, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once was talking to Aisha radiallahu anha, and he said to her, لولا أن أهلكي حديث عهد بالإسلام, because your people are fresh to the Islam, are new. Otherwise, look at the wish of Rasulullah. Otherwise, I would have rebuilt the Kaaba. I would have what? Rebuilt the Kaaba the way it was built by Ibrahim alayhi salam. But subhanAllah, he cares about the people's sentiments, that they may not feel comfortable to tear down the Kaaba and rebuild it again. SubhanAllah, this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he didn't do it. And Rasulullah passed away. And the time of Abu Bakr will come, and the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, and Umar and Uthman and Ali and all those beautiful Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa ardahum. And the Kaaba will remain the same way until the time of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, his name is Abdullah, the son of Az-Zubayr. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, he married Asma bint Abi Bakr, which is the sister of Aisha. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Aisha radiallahu anha, is his what? Is his auntie, his am, his khala. He heard her once saying that Rasulullah said so. He heard her saying that Rasulullah said once he wished to rebuild the Kaaba. And subhanAllah, Abdullah ibn Zubayr was the ruler at that time of Mecca. I'm not going to go to all the political things that took place, but it was also another flood that took place in the Kaaba, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr decided to rebuild the Kaaba. So he rebuilt the Kaaba. And this time he rebuilt it the old way, the way it was built by Ibrahim alayhi salam. So once he built it and he finished it, subhanAllah, there was a lot of things going on in the Muslims' land, fighting, disputing. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, and it's a very sad things to say in this era, subhanAllah, he will be killed. So the person will take over, he will tear down the Kaaba, and he will rebuild it again the way it was built in the time of Rasulullah before Islam. Subhanallah. Probably he didn't ask, he didn't even try to ask. When this information reached the king at that time, he called the imam of that time, which was the most respectful person, was the imam of Al-Madina. And who else? It is actually Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas. So he called him and he asked him, he said, what about what Abdullah ibn Zubayr did? He said, oh king, what he did is the right thing. Yes, Rasulullah wanted to do so. He said, so he was right. And we tear down the Kaaba and we rebuilt it the way. He said, yes. He said, should I do that again? Tear it down and rebuild it? And again, the wisdom of Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah, and look at the beauty of the people. He said, oh king, if we do that, the Kaaba will become like a toy. Nobody will respect it. Everyone will come and tear it down and rebuild it the way he wanted. No, don't do that. So since then, the Kaaba stayed the way that we see it right now. Of course, there was a lot of improvement, talking about the cloud of the Kaaba, the extension of the Haram, subhanAllah, but no rebuilding the Kaaba again or tearing down the Kaaba, subhanAllah. So it will remain like that. Everyone loved the Kaaba, respect the Kaaba. Going now, I'm just going to the most major time. The only sad part, which is probably you should know about this, it will happen in the time of what we call Al-Qaramita. Al-Qaramita is a group of people who used to rule in Al-Bahrain. It's a Shia sect. And by the way, that time, the Muslims were, or most of it was ruled by Shia's family in Egypt, by Al-Fatimiyin, which is Al-Ubaydiyin. In that time, a very sad, a tragic things took place in the Kaaba or around the Kaaba. A person name is Abu Tahir Al-Qurmuti. He will come from Al-Bahrain. He will come to Mecca, to the Kaaba, on the day of Al-Hajj, on the day, on the 10th of Dhul Hijjah. While the Muslims were making tawaf, he will attack them and he will kill a lot of them like goats. And he took out this black stone from each place. And he will go around and he will start saying a challenge. Aina hiya tayru ababil? Look what he's saying. Where is the tayr ababil? You remember the story how Abraha wanted to destroy the Kaaba and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent tayr ababil to destroy him. So this guy was challenging. So he took the black stone and he took it to Al-Bahrain and it stays there for quite 2 decades, around 20 something years. And with the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone will be able again to bring the black stone and put it back. By the way, the black stone now that you're going to see there is not a stone, but it's actually few stones because that black stone was cracked into around 8 pieces, small and big one. So what they did, they put it in a cement and then they put a silver around it so nobody will be able to remove it anymore. After that, subhanAllah, the Kaaba will remain the way it is until the time of the Turk, the Ottoman Empire, which is will do more improvement to the Kaaba, more improvement to the flooring of the Kaaba. And then the biggest expansion of the Kaaba will be happening in our time in the 20s and 30s and 40s until the Malik, subhanAllah, in the Saudi's kingdom, which is they will improve that even more better, subhanAllah. So this is in a brief, if you want, although we took more than 40 minutes. to talk about what? To talk how the Kaaba was, how during the time of Ibrahim and Ismail and the time of before Islam, how the idol worshipping, the time of Rasulullah, after Rasulullah, and few incidents that took place at that time. Now remember, when you go to that place, I want you to focus only one thing, that in this area, who walked around, who breathed that air, who looked at those mountains, who was there, who put his forehead on the ground? خير الخلق محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم إبراهيم عليه السلام إسماعيل عليه السلام موسى عليه السلام yes صالح عليه السلام and you name them and the most beautiful people that we know أبو بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وطلحة والزبير وعبد الرحمن and all the beautiful women سبحان الله خديجة رضي الله عنها عائشة رضي الله عنها حفصة رضي الله عنها سودة رضي الله عنها These are. So when you are in that area, just remember, you are in the area of what? The area of angels, the area of the people of Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and enable us and accept from us. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ I will stop over here. So we'll...
Prepare for the transformative journey of a lifetime. Visit our website and follow us for more information. Like